make me more like you. Change me, oh God. Wash me of you. Change me, oh God. Make me more. Wash me through and through. Just create in me a clean. Change something about you. Change.
Change me.
Whatever's not like you, Lord, I want you to.
Change me.
Do it for me, Lord. I dare you to just put your
change
hands on yourself.
Change me.
Lord, I want you to change me.
Change me.
Like only you can, Lord. Change me.
Change me.
Can y'all help me say it? It's easy. Like you mean it. Change me.
Change me.
Whatever's not like you, Lord, I want you to. From the inside out, Lord. Oh, a little change. I need you to.
The question is the gospel a message of peace and love? And I would say, of course. But we live out the gospel in a world that is not peaceful and is not loving. And therefore, it becomes incredibly disruptive. And I find it interesting and sad that so many expressions of Christianity in our context are so easily ignored. They're not something that people get upset about or excited about. They're just kind of there, and it's an option. You know, if you do the church thing, cool. If not, cool. And that's just so not what I see in Scripture, and more specifically the book of Acts, where you see the disciples going out, and every city that they went to, there were intense emotional reactions to the gospel, whether intensely in favor of it or intensely against it. People either converted and joined them and radically changed their lives and started giving, or they hated them and they wanted to drive them out of their city and stone them and kill them. But there was never this ignoring of it. And so I think about that, and it comes to a head in Acts chapter 17. It's one of my favorite passages of scripture, where they had reached the city of Thessalonica, and the people of the city say, those, talking about Christians, those who have turned the world upside down have come to our city as well. And I think that's what it is. That's what the faith does to, when it's expressed authentically, it completely changes everything. And people who understand it, whether they believe it or not, they will see that. They'll notice that. And they'll be like, this gospel, this Jesus thing changes everything. And either I'm going to be a part of it or I'm not. But it's not something that will be ignored. So this is a poem I kind of wrote around that theme. It's time to change the pace. Rethink the plan. Reset the hands of time to approximately 33 AD. We all just received the Great Commission, and there's no handbook or howtodomissions.com. No data, no graphs keeping track of how many souls we save, no missions organizations or board of directors, no hierarchy aside from the Lordship of Christ, and He just told us to go. God forbid we tiptoe our way to the uttermost parts of the earth. There's no place for fretful feet when the message we're carrying saves lives. You know as well as I, our task is urgent. But I can see the fear in your eyes. Our future is uncertain, and we feel so vulnerable because Christ told us the world would be against us. But if the Lord sent us, then His Spirit will go with us. So we pray for courage and proceed. For if we let fear stop us, we can't let fear stop us. This is too real. It changes everything, and everyone needs to know, and we'll do anything so they can. Even if it means changing everything. For we believe God is doing something new, something great, something we don't fully comprehend, but we walk by faith. And when we enter a place, whether or not souls are saved, people will say, those who turn the world upside down have come here as well. Indeed we did, letting the nations know that it's time to change the pace, rethink the plan, reset the hands of time to now. Now we remember our calling is ancient. We are not the first to go, but we may be the last. So how will we conclude this legacy of revolutionaries? To follow in the footsteps of pioneers requires we not follow in their footsteps, but tread upon grounds untrodden. Have we forgotten that God is doing something new, something great, something we don't fully comprehend, but we walk by faith as we change the pace, rethink the plan, reset the hands of time until it ends. Yeah. Thank you.
Good morning, dear friends. This is Pastor George Mims, Church of the Living God in Pittsburgh, California. It is so wonderful to be able to see you once again and to fellowship with you. And I'm excited about the word today, but before we go forward, let's have a brief word of prayer. God, we just thank you once again for allowing us to be alive today, to be a part of the day that you've created. We desire to rejoice and be glad in it. Open the hearts and the ears of those that are listening today. And God, bridle my tongue that I might speak your words and not my own, that I might bring you glory and not myself. We ask these blessings in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. I am so excited. God has woken me up this morning, and there's something in my heart that I believe is for someone that is tuning in today. When you think about the life that God is calling us to live, he's calling us to live divergent lives, lives that are in drastic opposition to the world's ways of how we should be living, the things that should be priority in our lives. I mean, you think about it, things like success. According to the world, success comes by you going at it by yourself, pulling yourself up by your bootstraps or stepping over others. But in God's economy, success comes from putting others before yourself, not doing it in vain conceit or doing it with humility. When we look at issues such as someone asking you to go 1 mile, according to the world, you do what's minimum in order that you don't waste time on some things that you're not supposed to do, but getting to what you want to do. But in God's economy, God says, I want you to go the extra mile. It's about doing not what's minimal, but what's necessary. We think about when people spread lies against you and they say all manner of evil against you falsely. The world says, hey, lawyer up, get somebody to be able to defend you. And if necessary, you go back at them and repay a blow for a blow. But you see, in God's economy and the ways that God is calling us to live, he says that we're in a favored position, that we're blessed when people speak evil against us and they lie against us, saying all manner of evil against us falsely, because he says our reward is in heaven. You see, unfortunately, even though God has specific ways that you and I are to live, there's still some things that remain in the body of Christ, that remain in the church, not because they have a spiritual root, but because we've allowed them to be acceptable things, acceptable furniture as part of the culture of church. One of those remnants is the issue of anger, is the issue of anger. If you ask anybody, what does the Bible say about anger? They'll tell you that, they'll talk about the words that Paul gave to the church at Ephesus, Ephesians 4 and 26. Be angry, but don't sin. Sin not. As if to say that anger is okay as long as you don't let it grow into sin. Here's the thing. When you begin to exegete and pull that passage apart to see exactly what the Apostle Paul is telling that church, he's not giving an issue of permission that anger is okay as long as it doesn't get to sin. He's issuing a warning. Because when you look at the B clause of that, it says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Give no place for the enemy. You see, we've come to a place where we've allowed things to remain, but God said that shouldn't be so. I want you not to be angry. We've given safe harbors to things in the church, in particular, anger. Why? Because of two things. One, because it's difficult sometimes for us to be vulnerable, to put ourselves in a place to be used. Philippians 2 said, let that mind be in us that was in Christ Jesus. He wasn't worried about reputation. He was moving by his purpose. But you see, anger remains in the body of Christ because it sometimes puts us in an uncomfortable place where we don't want to be vulnerable. The second reason that anger tends to be a part of the fabric of church is that it's made its way into all facets of our lives. You see, we've allowed it to get wrapped around spiritual arteries and places where that are precious to us, so that when you and I confront the anger, when we bring it before God and God tells us to go and to reconcile, we become hesitant because it means changing and flipping over major parts of our lives, because we've let the sun go down on it and it's taken root deeply. Some people say, you know what, Pastor, you don't understand. This thing goes back decades. It goes back generations, that folks are still angry and upset about things. But you see, I'm reminded of the scripture in Joel chapter 2, verse 25, when God is telling Israel, he said, the things that were destroyed, the things that should have been, the crops that you're worried about, he says that I will restore the years, the things that the cankerworm has taken away. Let me say this, if God can restore things of the ground, surely he can reconcile lives. If he can go into speaking to the natural things, and cause spiritual things to come alive, surely he can fix a relationship that's been tattered at the margins, a relationship that's been broken and shattered into a million pieces. We serve a God that speaks into nothing, and all of a sudden nothing has to conform into whatever he says must be. This morning, you see, we're dealing with issues that ought not be in the church, and that's the issue of anger. You see, the thing about it is that God was saying that I can restore the things that ought to be. Paul says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. I heard somebody once say that, hey, that's why I get angry in the morning time, so I can enjoy being angry all day. Or it doesn't make no sense to get angry in the evening time and all of a sudden I don't get time to enjoy it. You see, those things that we talk about in terms of being angry, allowing anger to be pervasive in our lives, it's something that the scriptures tell us, no, let's get rid of that. Let's go and restore things. Let's go and reconcile things. I remember years ago, it was a situation many years ago, about 20 plus years ago, that I was angry over a situation. The details are not necessary. What became apparent to me is that the more I began to let it fester, I didn't deal with it. I didn't deal with it before the sun went down. I let days and weeks and months go by, and things began to come in my mind that I thought, like, my goodness, I can't believe me, the person that's trying to live a upstanding and moral life, could think such vile and wicked things. But you see, because I had not followed God's instructions, but I said, you know what, out of sight, out of mind, as long as I don't see it, I don't have to deal with it, and eventually it'll go away. But that anger and that frustration, it rooted in my life and began to when I would think about naming the situation, I would get angry, my emotions would change, and my blood pressure would go up. You see, God has called for us to deal with things head on. But if you and I rely on our natural might and our natural vision, we will say, you know what, we'll get to it tomorrow or next week, that it's not causing any havoc in our lives. But the truth of the scripture remains is that if we let it remain, it'll find its place going everywhere in our lives. You'll go out and be in a restaurant. All of a sudden, a name that sounds like the name of the person that you should be reconciling with will come up. And your whole disposition will change. Some folks will be out with family members in another state and see something that reminds them of the thing that God is saying, I want you to go back and deal with that. You see, God has called for us to live a life of freedom, but that's not freedom to the degree that we can do what we want to do, but freedom in the purpose for which Jesus shed his blood, that you and I might not be constricted by the sin of this world and this flesh, that it might not reign over us, that it might not steal the joy that comes from God, but that you and I might be agents of change, that we go out and we share the good news of the gospel so that others might be free. But you see, some people can't be free this morning because they can't share the message of freedom because they're not free themselves. Are there things that you're contending with? Are there situations that you brought out of 2020 and you brought it into 2021? And if the trajectory and the trend keeps going that way, you'll take it into next year as well. I am convinced in looking at the word of God that anger is not something that God intends. Now, I know we look at Jesus going into the temple and he turns over the table of the money changers. But here was the Lord talking about his father's house being perpetrated for a fraud. That's not the mission that God has called you and I to. They are real relationships that God says, I've called you to reconcile. I've called you to show my glory and to confront that thing so that I can be invited in, so that I can restore and give life to everybody that's been affected. That's not the same as Jesus turning over the tables of the money changers. You see, if God can restore a relationship in your life, if he could fix a situation, if he could come this morning and you would be guaranteed that it would be resolved, where would you ask Jesus to go? Are there several places that you would ask him to visit to restore relationships? Is there a fear of being hurt again? Fear of being vulnerable to the place where you're so uncomfortable that you can't control the outcome? I hope this doesn't come as a spoiler alert, but that's the place where God says, my peace reigns. It's in a place where you and I let go of the steering wheel and allow God to do the driving. It's when you and I put ourselves in a place, as Jesus did, to take off his reputation and lay it aside and take on the role of a servant. It's in that place that you and I become all that we were created to be, and God's will and his purpose is glorified. Somebody this morning needs to get on that journey, go down that road of restoration so that you can free the rest of your life. I know that God is blessing you, and I know that he's shining his light over you, that he's keeping you in good health and protecting your children and parents and doing many wonderful things. But the question I have is that, are you leaving some benefit on the table? Are there some things that God says, you thought that was something? If you go and take care of my business, watch what I'll do. Watch the greatness that I'll bring in. Watch the relationships that I restore. I will enlarge your territory. But it starts with you and I being vulnerable first, us following all of God's commandments, not just some of them. If I'm speaking to you this morning, I'm excited because I believe that there is some reprieve, there's some freedom in the scriptures this morning. There's a place that God is calling us to, but that place doesn't come without sacrifice. It doesn't come without some scars and some facing and confrontations of things and places that the enemy is trying to take strongholds over in our lives. You see, the enemy is fine. He can't take our life, but if he can hold us up, if he can apprehend us from going and doing the things that God has called, then we might as well be dead because we're just as ineffective. But this morning, somebody needs to be free. This morning, somebody is going to step from bondage into freedom and start walking without reservation and hesitation of where you go or who you talk to. It's in that place that I believe the Lord is calling us today. Let's turn to the scriptures this morning. I'm excited. I don't want to get ahead of myself. You see, this morning we're going to be coming from the book of St. Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 24. It's in the place that we were in the Sermon on the Mount last week, and we're going to stay here for a while to start to unpack the things that Jesus has laid out in this great sermon. Here's what it says. Verse 21 says, "You've heard that our ancestors were told, you must not murder. If you commit murder, you are subject to judgment." Let me go to my next verse, 21, verses 22. 22 says, "But I say to you that if any of you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, you fool, you will be liable to hellfire." Verse 23 says this, "So if you are presenting a sacrifice at the altar in the temple and you suddenly remember that someone has something against you." Verse 24 and final verse says, "Leave your sacrifice there at the altar. Go and be reconciled to that person. Then come and offer your sacrifice to God." That's huge. That's a big thing of what Jesus is saying to these people that are on the hillside. You see, for generations, they've known about going to the temple. They've known all of the rules and commandments, the guides for bringing a sacrifice. It had to be holy. It had to be offered in a certain fashion. There were specifics about how you could come and offer sacrifices and worship and tribute to the Lord. You see, God is a God of specificity. But you see, Jesus said that if you have some things, you need to put those things on pause and go take care of some other paths, some other things that are necessary. There are a couple of things that I want to leave with you this morning, and I'll be out of your way. But I just believe that somebody is on the edge of being freed from thoughts and things that have apprehended your joy and stolen time away from you and time with your family. The first thing that I leave with you is that the pathway to murder goes across and through the road of anger. The pathway to get to murder, we think about murder in extreme sense. My goodness, I'd never thought about murdering anybody. But if you get on that road of anger, its destination ends in tragedy. You may say, you know what, Pastor, that's great, but I barely heard a bird, or I'm cautious about stepping on ants on the sidewalk. There's a story, true story, down in Southern California. Took place a couple of years ago. Two men going down the highway, and they road raged, you know, what was the issue. And they started a back and forth. But before they got on the highway, the argument started in the parking lot of a sporting goods store. By the time they got to the highway, they're chasing each other with these cars and still throwing fingers and making all kinds of accusations, traveling at high speeds down the highway. They get off and go into a community, still arguing, still angry at one another. When one of the gentlemen cuts off the other car, and in order to avoid the accident, the other car throws his steering wheel in the other direction. By the time the argument is over, a little girl that was on the side of the street was killed in the process. You see, these men, though they were angry, they didn't kill one another. But the Bible says that the end of this thing, the end of those feelings, results in issues of murder. This happened to be an incident that was unsolicited by this young girl, but yet, because of the anger that these two men engaged in, the little girl lost her life. You see, the pathway that goes on, sometimes we think that, you know, oh, Pastor, you don't understand. I'm a good person. I don't get that angry. I got real good control. The Bible says that you and I, when we think about it, our heart, the things that we think about, the Bible says it's more deceitful above all things. Excuse me, who can know it? Here's the point that the author says, is that you and I, even on our best days, are not strong enough to overtake and to understand the things that we think that we have clear line of sight of. You see, when we think about our heart being good, the Lord says it's evil, it's wicked above all things. Who can know it? Only the Lord. And so you and I must succumb. We must surrender to God's control over our lives. But the pathway that we must never take, that we must root up out of the church, we must say that, you know what, anger is fine on the outside, but if we as believers, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we cannot let anger be in our company. Anger can't sit at the table of fellowship. Anger can't be a part of the worship service. Anger, if there's things that you and I have that is undone, that we need to take care of, let us do it that we may worship and glorify God in his fullness. You see, the pathway to the thing that Jesus says, that you've heard it one time in the old code in the Torah, that thou shalt not murder. And again, remember what I said, God doesn't call us to do the minimum. He calls us to do what's necessary in order for you and I to live fully in his heart and in his economy. We must rid ourselves of the anger that's around us. The second thing is not only the pathway of murder leads to anger, but the priority of God is to deal with the anger first. The priority of God is to deal with the anger. I remember growing up in church, and I've been a part of many churches over the years. My mama would drag me to 3 o'clock programs. We go to 5 o'clock programs. It seemed like Sunday, everybody had a program, and it's like they all talked to one another, and the programs that would start at different churches were one after another. You might get in bed on Sunday night at 11 o'clock, but my goodness, but every church you would go to, everyone would lift an offering. Everyone had a place where there's an opportunity for people to be able to give. That was part of church. But here's the thing that Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5. If you've brought an offering, and again, we're talking about sacrificial offerings of the old covenant, where you would bring animal sacrifices, you would bring the things that were necessary to bring you to constitute your worship. When we think about it today, Jesus is saying, leave that at the altar. Sometimes we think that God has more stock in the things that we're giving him directly, but Jesus makes it clear that the priority is not about what you bring and put in the offering plate. It's not about the sacrifice of your time in prayer and in worship before God, especially if you recognize that there is separation, if there's daylight between you and somebody else. Jesus says, leave that there. I don't want to receive that offering until you go take care of the priority. He says, go when you recognize that your brother has aught against you, leave your sacrifice at the altar and go take care of that. I envision in heaven at the receiving dock of heaven, there's probably a lot of worship and offering that's left there on the dock that God says, I can't receive that yet. I'm waiting to see the relationship that's reconciled, that's tied to this offering here. You see, the things that sometimes we get in a posture to where we want to impress God by our actions of what we do directed towards heaven. But God says that, you know what, if you're going to worship me, I need you to look to your left and look to your right. Make sure those relationships are in order, because Jesus said himself that the will of the Father, John 6:39, is that all that sees the Son and believes, that I'll raise him up at that last day. You see, God's desire is that everybody might be saved. But Jesus is saying that it does no good for us to offer physical, material worship when our relationship with the one that God is trying to call to himself through us is broken, is constrained, is restricted by the argument or the anger between us. God says that my priority is the people. The will of the Father is that everybody would be saved, that none might perish. Here's the last thing that I leave with you. Not only is the priority for us to deal with the anger first, but you and I, the purpose is that all might be saved. The purpose for our living and our giving is that all might be saved. The purpose for the sacrifice that the Lord is calling us to, when we're supposed to have that same humility and servant mindset in us. It's not for the sake of you and I getting our blessing, that our blessing is around the corner. No, it's that when the Lord comes back, that all that he intended to be saved might be caught up to meet him in the air, that you and I might be used for God's purpose. Remember, we were bought with a price. I hope this doesn't hurt anybody's feelings, but God is not necessarily concerned about how you and I feel, because you see, it's the Lord that speaks in the things and he causes things to be. And so if you and I need to have an attitude shift, God said that I can put some things in your life to bring joy, but I'm looking for some servants. I'm looking for some people that are willing to follow my commandments, willing to live for me in this life, that all that my desires are in order to raise those from the dead, to save those that are lost, that might happen fully. That again, John 6:39, God said, my desire is that my will be done, that everybody that's intended to be saved might be saved. I use for a topic this morning, living with the enemy. Sometimes we see the enemies as people with flesh and blood that looks like us, that neighbors down the street or folks on the job, folks in the supermarket or people we see on TV that are spreading and shouting all kinds of things across the tube. That's not the true enemy. The true enemy is the enemy is the spirit of disobedience, that you and I can somehow figure out a way to not follow God because we rationalize why his ways don't make sense. God has called us to live divergent lives. Lives that are in stark contrast and in conflict, in some cases, with the ways that the world encourages us to live by. But you see, this morning, the Lord said that if you follow me, if you take on my ways, he said, if you're willing to be my people, I will be your God. God plus you is the majority. I don't care how many people come against you. I don't care how many people tear you down or spread lies on you. If the Lord is on your side, then who can be against you and be successful? Who can come against you to succeed? There is truly no weapon formed against you that can prosper as long as the Lord is on your side. So today it starts with a willingness to be courageous in the Lord. I'm not sure who I'm speaking to, but I know that there's somebody right now that needs to deal with some things today, not tomorrow, not next week. There are some relationships that are tattered, and the Lord is calling on you to handle those. If the Lord is speaking to your heart, if you don't know Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sins, you say, Pastor, I hear you, I understand it, but this Jesus thing, I'm not sure, but I'm willing to give him a starting place. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 said, if you confess with the Lord Jesus, if you confess him with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. If you're willing to confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and believe in your heart right now that God has raised him from the dead, that Jesus is sitting on the right hand of the Father, the Bible says that you're saved in that moment. If you've made that profession of faith and confession, I welcome you. I wish I could reach my arms out to you, but I want to welcome you into the body of Christ. And I am encouraged and I'm excited to be able to encourage you along the way of this life that God has called us to, divergent, but full of his glory and honor. I want to thank you for joining us today, and I look forward to seeing you next week. In the meantime, stay tuned. There's some important messages coming up after our service. God bless.
I believe.